I am not going to spend a lot of time on biographies. I think we want to hear substance. So I will quickly introduce my colleague and friend, Holly Doraemus, a leading natural resource and environmental lawyer from our sister campus at what used to be called Bold and now is the University of California Law School. Thank you, Holly.
Thanks, Joe. Berkeley Law, I think that's how we're supposed to be branding ourselves these days. Well, it's really a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate the invitation. As we've heard in the earlier introductions, there have long been very good people at UC Irvine working on various aspects of dealing with the environment. And now with the new law school, there's all kinds of exciting things going on here and exciting opportunities. And it's really fun to be part of one of the early manifestations of that. So I want to talk about climate change and property rights a little bit. And Americans are sort of curiously divided about property rights. You know, when I was thinking about this, I was thinking of saying schizophrenic, but I don't think that's right, because I think there are different groups of people that have different views or pay attention to different parts of the views. On the one hand, people who deal with property law know that the rules of property law, like other legal rules, can, do, must change over time to accommodate changing circumstances and changing values. And in fact, a number of lawyers and legal academics would say that property law is one of the most dynamic areas of the law. At the same time, there's a powerful desire for stability, a powerful rhetoric about stability, and a belief among many in the public that property is quite stable, that the rules about property are and should be quite stable, based on the fact that we make important social and economic investments, that we have this psychological attachment to the status quo, and there's also a sense in America that property is this keystone right, you know, the guardian of all other rights. So property rights do change over time. They have changed over time historically. It's not easy to change property rights, and it's really not easy to change the perception that property rights don't and shouldn't change. That is problematic for environmental protection, in part because environmental interests in the United States came late to the party. We didn't figure out that we cared about the environment until a lot of property rights had already been allocated without much attention to that. Property rights, you know, the environment doesn't begin to seem threatened. We don't perceive the loss of the environment until there's a certain level of crowding on the landscape. And at that point, we already have set expectations in place with respect to much of the land and even more of the water in the United States. But private interests underprotect the environment because environmental costs and benefits are both difficult to internalize. So that's not to say, and I definitely don't mean to say here, that I think property rights are always inimical to the environment. They definitely are not. There are ways that property rights can be used to enhance environmental protection. And indeed, they may be a necessary foundation for ordering resource allocation at all in our market society. But if property rights are too strong, if individual property rights are too strong, they can privilege economic returns above all kinds of other things that we might care about, and they can interpose artificial boundaries that greatly complicate the management of the kinds of unbounded resources. And Alex just explained to us how those the wildlife and plants, natural resources, are going to ignore boundaries even more aggressively than they've done in the past as we get to the future. So there have been any number of commentators. Of course, it's not at all new to say that property rights, strong individual property rights, can be difficult for environmental protection to deal with. And a lot of commentators have decried the inconsistency of the popular rhetoric of property rights with the reality of changing law, and have talked about how environmental protection is interfered with or made more difficult by strong property rights. And they've talked about property as a dynamic institution and suggested, recommended all kinds of things that would help green property law. But I think there hasn't been a lot of systematic exploration in this context of how property transitions occur and why they might not occur in some circumstances, what the tools for change might be, and how those tools might be deployed. So that's what I'm trying to get at in this project. And I'm still struggling a bit with it, but I think I can say a few things at this point. How does that relate to climate change? Well, I think climate change comes in not just because it's the trendy thing of the moment and everybody has to talk about climate change. It comes in because climate change, I think, heightens the disconnect between current understandings of property, especially if we're going to freeze current property law and societal goals, because climate change might provide a kind of Republican moment, something that might be essential to big changes, if you will, in property allocation and property rules. But it also might not. So what I wanted to look at was something more about how exactly do property rights change. And it turns out that there's a conventional story about that developed by economists, with the leading paper being an article by Harold Demsitz in 1967 called Toward a Theory of Property Rights. It's a story about the evolution of property rights where there had been none before, the evolution from a commons to more individuated rights. And Demsitz argued that property rights, individuated property rights, emerge when the benefits of recognizing those rights exceed the cost. Well, Demsitz is an economist. What else would you expect him to say, right? Benefits exceed the cost. And the way he was thinking about that was that the benefits are those of internalizing the damage from overuse of a resource. So very much the tragedy of the commons story, right? And as the value of the exploited resource goes up, Demsitz said, the losses from overexploiting it in a commons situation also go up. And his example is about the Montagne Indians who began to recognize hunting territories, kind of property rights in hunting territories, when markets for beaver pelts were brought to, developed in North America, and the beaver pelts became much more valuable. Then he says the benefits of dividing up the commons exceeded the cost of dividing up the commons, by which he means sort of the cost of marking property, identifying its pieces, and enforcing rights. So changes on either side of that equation can make the emergence of property rights more likely. Since Demsitz, of course, this, a lot of other economists and political economists have explored these kinds of issues, and they've brought up the point that, of course, if you're going to talk about the transaction costs, you have to include interest group politics and the ability to block transactions and when that will occur and when that won't. I think there are a number of things to notice about this conventional story. One is that it's very backward-looking and descriptive, right? People have looked at changes that have occurred and tried to explain why they did occur. It's been very much focused on the strengthening of private property rights, and there tends to be sort of an assumption in that literature that evolution of property rights is a one-way process towards stronger and stronger, more and more individuated, if you will, property rights. And I think that's because the people talking about this tend to be economists of the school that think that stronger property rights is better for economic growth and development, and that that's the way that things ought to be moving. It's also, you know, starting with the Demsit story, to some extent, it kind of assumes that everyone is made better off by the move towards stronger property rights. To the extent that that's not true, and as people have begun to notice that it's not necessarily true, this conventional story may require, and indeed some people looking at it have said that it does require, serious inequities in society. That you may have to have a situation where you have elite winners in the property change game who can ignore the costs to downtrodden losers, or at least can get the political process to ignore those costs. And then finally, I think one of the things to notice is that it's a kind of, in this conventional story, it's a punctuated evolution rather than sort of a smooth progress, because there have to be steps where things change. So things may go along in a particular way for many years, and then there's some kind of a sharp transition there. So what does this story have to do with climate change? Well, climate change, as I see it, is going to destabilize, is already destabilizing, expectations of what property provides for its owners, and perhaps also for what property provides to society. It's going to emphasize not just the permeability of boundaries, which we've known about for some time, but the importance of dynamism and the extent to which natural systems are dynamic, and the ways in which that can be problematic for human use of land and of water. I think it will change the efficiency of existing allocations, but not, I think, in ways that the market is likely to fix, or at least to fix quickly. And it will change the suitability of the rules of allocation, which is something that markets can't change. Climate change will change landscapes, it will change the likelihood of extreme events, it will change hydrology, it would change where species live and want to live, et cetera. And all of those natural changes, if you will, those become the problem of government, and they become a problem about property rights, because governments are going to want to respond by changing the ways that they regulate what people can do on the land, by getting people out of flood zones, if you will, by not allowing them to armor coastlines, by requiring that they tolerate species coming onto their land, all of those kinds of things. So although climate change is going to change land and water sort of directly, but that's going to bring pressure for a number of changes that will be mediated by governments. And eventually, there will be a response. The rules of property will change. The allocation of property will change. I've got sort of three concerns about the way that'll happen, which lead me to think that we should think about how we might push it in certain directions. One is that the inflexibility of property rights, or if we act as if property rights are inflexible, that may inhibit adaptive responses to climate change, and it may encourage moral hazard, people putting themselves, if you will, in harm's way, And it will make it difficult to prevent that kind of thing, to act ahead of time, to get people to even protect themselves. Second thing I worry about is if we wait for a crisis to respond, which we typically do, that will actually maximize the disruptive effect change, the transition, and minimize the chance that that transition will be made in a way that has some nuance to it, that considers how things ought to happen. And then finally, I think if change occurs in a moment of crisis where it looks like the interests of people are very much at stake, I think we're quite likely to forget that we care about the environment, that we care about fish, that we care about other kinds of species, because we're not going to care if it looks like fish are keeping people from drinking. But if we act in advance, we may well be able to prevent that kind of sharp conflict. So I'm really interested in how the rules of ownership might change and how the rules about changing the rules might change and might be important here. And I'm interested in changes that weaken individual property rights but strengthen collective claims, because I think those are going to be important to adaptation. So I think the history that we ought to look at is a history of situations in which those kinds of changes have occurred and or have not occurred, and try to see why that is, what we can understand about it. And actually, you know, there have been a number of such changes, which I'll mention in just a bit. I think what we need in order to change the rules and change the rules about the rules in sensible ways, I think we need an active judiciary, one that's not shy about its role, an engaged legislature that understands the kinds of problems that are being faced, and a concerned public. And let me just say, I have no confidence whatsoever that that confluence will come together. In fact, I think it's most likely that it won't. But if we don't talk about it, then for certain it won't. The judiciary, I think, is the keystone institution because it controls the rules about changing the rules. That's takings doctrine. And by and large, it controls the rules of property at state levels, and it controls the rules about reading legislation and understanding what it means. Property law in the US is really, to a surprising degree, at least to me, still a common law doctrine, where the basic rules are sketched out in these kind of broad principles that are subject to interpretation according to the context of the times. And that the courts actually have, in several instances, loosened the strength of established property rights. But they've never quite said it that way. So maybe, you know, that's part of the strategic thing here, is that courts can't quite say it that way or feel that they can't. What's been changed by courts? Well, famous example is nuisance, which is a doctrine that protects the owners of property, protects the use and enjoyment of land against damage from the outside. Used to be in England, before the Industrial Revolution, that it was thought to protect landowners against harmful invasions, period. And in the course of the Industrial Revolution, we shifted to an idea that there was a balancing of interests here, and only harmful invasions that were also unreasonable were prohibited. More recently, we've had what kinds of things? Well, if you think about Shelley versus Kramer, where the US Supreme Court said that it was unconstitutional to have racially restrictive covenants. That was a change in individual property rights, came from the courts and their interpretation of the Constitution, and racially restrictive covenants had been quite widespread. More recently, we can think about, there actually has been some change in response to environmental concerns, and you can think about the public trust doctrine, right, which the courts took from a focus on fishing and navigation in common to saying that the public trust doctrine reflects access to beaches and the ability to recreate on beaches and requires ecosystem protection, at least in some places and in some ways. I think the focus on the courts is also important here because it's become systematically more difficult for courts to do this kind of thing, I think, in the last generation. In part, that's because of all the rhetoric about activist judges. It's harder for judges to say, we are common law judges, we are going to change things as we think conditions require. That's especially true at the federal level, but I think it's even more so, it's even true at the states, although the judges do have some political responsiveness there, and maybe concerns about activism shouldn't be as strong. Takings doctrine looks like it's emphasizing this kind of thing. In terms of the rules about changing the rules, courts have been hesitant to talk about transitions directly, and they've made up a lot of formalistic sorts of rules to avoid that. So I think the judges have, the judiciary has to be the key, but there also has to be legislative involvement. There's a lot that only legislatures can do in terms of planning in advance, setting up the details. But then judges have to say, yeah, this is okay. And we can see this dynamic in the when zoning began to be widespread, and then the court in Euclid said, yes, it's okay. I think they're also, in order, and actually legislatures have acted in various ways that do cut back in exactly the ways that we might want, beach acts in the Texas Beach Act and other such things. But now the Supreme Court's going to consider how much judges can do that, right? The Stop the Beach Renourishment case that they've taken up this term raises exactly that kind of question. I think we also need, in order for legislatures to act, we have to have larger public concerns. I think those need to be there needs to be an understanding of why adaptation is important, why conventional property rights might make it difficult, and an understanding of what markets can and can't do. They can reallocate rights in some ways that are very useful. They're not good at changing rules, and they won't take into account sort of inherently collective goods. So I think really what we're going to need in a warming world is property rules that are more flexible, more dynamic, and I think recognizing a strong public interest allows that kind of flexibility. There's no final answers there, but the public authorities get to make more and more decisions, and leaving those decisions in individual private hands is likely to be quite problematic. Thank you.